seven esports world championships here in Seoul, South Korea. My name is Reed Rappenbelt, and of course, joining me, Marika from South Africa, sport player for a national team, and we are back with game number two. Coming up here in the third and fourth place match, best of three.
And if you missed the first one, you missed a lot. We saw Hecarim dominating the whole game, but I'll let you see.
All right, well, we probably won't be seeing that again. But when we get into picks and bans here in just a second, looking for Hecarim bans, possibly, and maybe a comeback from Switzerland to keep themselves in this best of three. But let's go ahead and get into our champion picks and bans. Bans coming your way for game number two. Switzerland swapping over to the blue side. They're going to ban out that Azir. Once again, focusing on banning out these mid lane champions, a strategy that left a whole lot open for Serbia in game one.
It looks like it's going to be exactly the same. And we can see Serbia takes away the Lulu yet again.
Same exact bans here.
They want to keep that away from Switzerland. I mean, you saw what they did against an almost comeback yesterday.
I mean, hey, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. For Serbia, that's the case. For Switzerland, a need to deal with this Hecarim. Now, they are swapping over to the blue side, so certainly an ability to first pick that one, but a tendency towards Calm Kench that is realized by Serbia with that ban.
I definitely don't want to give that to Switzerland as a first pick, but do you give them Lee Sin or do you give them Hecarim?
Oh, you don't give them Lee Sin. It's over and over again. Koala with the hat, just proving he is very, very dominant with that champion. Now, also Kindred left available, but each one of these teams prioritize Kindred very, very differently. For double aim, great champion. For the Swiss squad, I was actually talking with Koala earlier, he's not quite as big a fan of running that Kindred in the jungle. So first off, we have to check out this last ban. So this is going to be most likely Lee Sin. Possibly that Hecarim that we saw be so strong in game one. Not willing to give that one away. Dr. Mundo, also a really strong pick in the current meta, so not a lot of bans left, Marika.
Dr. Mundo's the drive-thru. Oh, wow.
Okay, we've got Dr. Mundo and Lee Sin. So this is actually really interesting from Serbia. They ban out a safe jungler, one of the stronger ones in Rek'Sai, and that means that there's not a whole lot to deal with Lee Sin once Rek'Sai's been banned.
Well, right now, you give them one strong pick and you take two, so there's a lot of...
Depends on how strong your pick is. So for Switzerland, they've got Dr. Mundo available. They've got Kindred available if they want to go for that. But like we said, you really can't pass up the opportunity to play Lee Sin. But this is actually what Serbia expects. They knew that they were leaving the Lee Sin open, and they knew that it was too good to pass up for Switzerland. Now let's see what their capitalization is on that Lee Sin pick.
But will this Tristana still be picked by Switzerland, even though Alistar is not there?
That combo no longer available, but there are a few other ones, though. We've seen Janna Caitlyn be very, very strong. Janna Vayne, another champion that Bigfoot has the ability to play.
You are not going to pick Vayne against the Lee Sin.
Well, it's not that, the matchup, but it's more that Bigfoot's super good at Vayne. He's also really good at Lucian, too, so he's got that versatility to play a little bit of a safer AD carry there. So, prioritizing, oh yeah, there's that Cola Max Hecarim. So, like I said, similarities to game number one already coming out in the picks. They get two of the strongest ones, but this time, Yama has the ability to think a little bit further about what champion he wants to counter as Hecarim.
I don't think he has a champion to counter Hecarim if you think about it, because look at Gnar. Gnar was supposed to be the counter. And how did that turn out? 11-1.
Yeah, definitely not quite the same amount of strength here. For Yama, the champions that we should be expecting here, maybe an, I want to say Irelia in that matchup, it doesn't work. So you're going to have to go for something maybe like a Vladimir for the split push, but then the all-in potential is really high. Calm Kench would be a great pick to go here into Hecarim, but of course that's banned. And there's the Lucian taken away from Bigfoot, given over to Pride.
That bot lane combo. Fresh Lucian, the Soul Stealer lane.
Well, yeah, definitely the 100% wife steal down there. We've got Lucian as the strongest champion for Pride. He also plays a little bit of Jinx, like we got a chance to see, but the Lucian is by far the strongest shared picks between both of these 80 carries. And nice to see that prioritized by Pride to both take a strong pick for Switzerland and limit that for Serbia.
The great thing for Lagley is that Serbia does not play Olivia or Ori, so you have your two comfort picks open and they won't be taken, so you can always just leave it for last. But I like Braum more. Yes, yes.
Yeah, there we go, locking it in. What's the AD carry pick here? Caitlyn, pretty decent with Braum, able to use that slow field in front of her to kite back away. And of course, the Vayne available. Vayne. We talked about it for Bigfoot. It has been his strongest champion. Not pickable in every scenario, but hey, when you're that good at it, you can pretty much count on a sure thing. Gonna be Vayne versus Lucian. And now, what are the last couple of picks here for Switzerland?
He must be feeling pretty confident picking that into Lee Sin. I mean, Lee Sin is going to camp bot lane constantly. Oh, actually, you might want to get a Lagley fed.
All right, but the mid lane picks have always been very impactful between both of these teams, with Switzerland showing a really predisposition to picking that Nivea. Also can go for a safer Orianna composition, and with this Malphite being hovered over, Orianna might be the go here, able to just get that ball delivery system working. Also, great idea to put that on Lee Sin as he goes in for those kicks, too. This is setting up to be something of an Orianna composition, but with the hover over on Yasuo, that could also be the mid lane choice for Lagley.
If they choose a squishy mid lane champion, he's just going to pick Zed.
Oh my gosh, the Karthus coming out. All right, that's what I like to see. A few tricks left in Switzerland's bag, and this is going to be exciting.
Zed? Karthus and Anivia. Froggen, is this you?
What on earth is about to happen? Like you said, there's a couple of mid lane picks left available for Milica. Did go through with the first two bans like last time, but like you said, left the Zed up, and that could be a pick here for Milica.
Echo.
Echo, a champion that we've actually seen the Chinese mid laner ever, Ricci Academy, pick a couple of different times when his champions were limited. So, haven't seen Milica really have quite as strong a showing as the Chinese squad did, but versus a Karthus. When's the last time you saw a Karthus play?
LCS. I know. No, never LCS. Solo queue. Yes.
All right.
2 years ago.
So it's been a while since Karthus has been a big deal. But anytime you're going to have a Malphite on your team, you've got the ability to have a lot of synergy with Abyssal Scepter, a lot of big hard engage. Even if Karthus dies, you can Malphite ult to keep everybody on top of that Defile. So interesting pick here. It's certainly a pocket pick for Lagley. Possibly not something that Serbia expected, but these very happy fans in the audience ready to get this game underway. We got picks and bans over with, some very strong, very unique picks for both sides. It's game four, Switzerland. If they can come back, we're going to a game three. If not, Serbia will take away third place here at the 7th Esports World Championship. So without further ado, let's get into game. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to game number two of the third and fourth place best of three match between Serbia and Switzerland here at the 7th Esports World Championship in Seoul, South Korea. If you guys are watching online, thanks for tuning in. And if you're here in Seoul, make sure to come down to the Nexon Arena to cheer these teams on. They represent their countries, of course, representing the mid lane for Switzerland, a Karthus pick. First time we've seen that all tournament long.
Well, this might just turn out to be the next Bard. We saw what Bard did yesterday, carrying China to a complete victory. Was it China or Korea?
Both actually play a lot of Bard. We actually haven't seen that. It's a secret pick. We'll talk about that later. Let's go ahead and talk about this Braum dance, the sickest one alive. Just going ahead and rocking out the Luchador. We've got Bigfoot. He doesn't know what's going on. He's just trying to walk around. It's like, what on earth are you doing? literally in the river and dance he's dancing
party.
Around. I was going to say, a lot of dance parties here. Of course, probably a lot after IESF is done as well. But we got a little bit of games left to play, so let's talk about how these teams are starting off. We've got most likely a double jungle start for Switzerland, possibly looking to see a solo camp taken here by Colamax at those Raptors.
I'm surprised to see Vayne going in lane and not doing a lane swap, especially against the Malphite.
Well, the biggest thing for Switzerland is that you don't actually see them lane swap ever. I was talking to them earlier, and they mentioned that might be one of the weaker parts of their strategic planning. So just always going to see standard lanes from Switzerland no matter what. Bigfoot actually going to aggro the first three melee creeps so that they all target the first melee for Serbia. And that actually causes the lane to push, so you're able to freeze it out. Should actually see Demented Clown get level 2 off the XP in lane, and then Roam, were that a 2v1. But of course, they already know they're going to be facing off against the 2v2. It'll be interesting to see who's going to get these level 2 advantage first.
Causes will be quite much so useless early game, but if they can drag this out, this might be a scary game for Serbia. But then you also have the Vayne to think about. This is a very mixed comp on both sides.
Garthus is a really good pick into melee mid laners. Now, granted, a lot of those are assassins like Diana, like Echo, who do have shields to mitigate that harass, but you know when a melee mid laner is going to come up and see us a minion, so pretty easy to deal with it that way. Now, my gosh, that kill onto the Scuttlecrab so quick.
And an early gank coming from him. No vision.
Yeah, level 3. Wild Joshy walking forward. There's the damage here. Nosy's in trouble. Flay backwards.
Surprise.
There's the mark to flash in, flash out. Wild Joshy still exhausted. Fumble forward there in a lot of trouble. Turns around for the death sentence, does get the pull. A lot of damage there onto double A and the luchador jumping in. Wild Joshy pretty low. We've got those concussive blows onto two, but it's first blood coming in for Koala. He's got that hat up there. He's looking for another kill. Trying to give this one to Pride, and he will. Two kills early for Switzerland.
And that's the power of the Lee Sin, just running past casually and destroying.
Yeah, one of the big question marks for me through this pick and ban phase, giving up that first pick Lee Sin, without a doubt Koala with the hat's the strongest champion, and it kind of goes without saying, we saw the power of Lee Sin yesterday for both the Chinese and Korean squads, just absolutely devastating the hands of a master, and it's kind of what Serbia has given Switzerland. Strong power pick already converting into kills. Red buff secured, a nice pickup afterwards, and oh man, maybe some kill potential here. Militia inside his shield, able to block that last lay waste and get out alive.
Both is doing some early work. I was indeed wrong, it seems.
Really abusable early on before these mid lane assassins can go in and assassinate, but this matchup changes totally once these guys hit level 6. A lot of burst damage possible for Echo, especially depending on what his first item is. Echo, you can go for some CDR early, you can go for just that Negatron cloak for the lane advantage, but oh, here onto Lagali, forcing that flash out.
That's one thing you don't want down on Karthus, especially with a Kindred in your enemy's jungle. But now,
Oh, man, if Koala had landed that Q, Militia might have been in a little bit of trouble. Koala not level 6, so no kick in there for the assassination, but now we're going to see how well Malphite kills Scuttlecrabs, and I'll give you a minor spoiler, or I get it's not good. Thankfully, he has some help from his team. Now backing up towards mid lane, got some power up here in Lee Sin. We'll see if he's going into the queue, looking for it, fishing for it, missing it. And that means that Yama's out of mana, only level 4, so not a whole lot to see here. But they have to continue to push this, otherwise Yama's going to be in a terrible spot with the lane frozen in front of the enemy turret.
But out of all the champions, I think Hesham is most capable of dealing with what they're giving to him right now. Horsepower.
Yeah, double aim up there to maybe step on the accelerator. But both teams just going towards top lane, being aggressive, and then walking away.
You rarely see that as soon as you see the jungle top, that your jungle goes bot and you rush dragon. This is an outdated play these days, but it's such a good missed play. Missed.
Opportunity.
Opportunity.
So bottom lane, we've got the duos there. Nothing happening at all other than a lot of pressure put onto Pride. Of course, that's a reaction to getting that early kill, be able to put it in some early itemization, whereas Vayne hasn't been back to base at all, still just sitting on that Doran's Blade, which is, it's not going to cut it for much longer. Those trades in lane just don't work when all you've got is a Doran's Blade. I mean, Doran's a pretty cool guy, right? He's got some good items. You want to start out with them, but you probably want to go for an upgrade here in the near future.
She just wants to wait for a proper item, because she died. You don't want to, or he died. Bigfoot not being a girl.
I mean, it depends on if you're talking about the player or
the champion.
The champion. But some reinforcements waiting in the wings is double aim. Probably looking to flip over that wall and go from around instead.
Leeson moving into the bot jungle as well. So
he's a ways out. A better play here for double aim is to go for the skull crab kill and get another stack for Wolf. And I think that's exactly what he's going to do. Likely out of mana here, but avoids those Z-Drive Resonance procs pretty well. Is able to just get enough mana back off of killing these creeps to clear out the wave and stay in that lane a little bit more.
Leeson going quite deep into the jungle, getting some proper vision down.
We actually saw that really punished against Switzerland yesterday, as every time he would try to go in there, that Bard would find him out there. Of course, that's yesterday's games. This is today, and of course, going into these deep wards, placing him out is going to find double A, but can he win that 1v1? Backing out, he's not level 6, and that's the big disadvantage here.
You don't want to be Lapsone in this case. Hecarim is level 6, so a TP would be devastating.
Oh, Thunderlord's getting some extra damage there onto Milic. Koala backing backwards, as backs tend to be. Yama in the top lane, having some struggles continually versus this very, very strong Koala Max Hecarim.
Still fighting over that blue buff. I'm surprised to see that Serbia does not go and contest this. They do have the number.
Oh, the spice! Good Koala! Locking it down here, an Algamid Demented Clown. Pretty confident walking forward because he knows that Lee Sin's not level 6, but also without eyes on Lagali, don't want to overextend and get flamed.
Vayne is not falling too far behind. Can see us, but it's not the end of the world. It's just yet 8 minutes and the death, the ganks. But where's Kindred without Leeson following him? Leeson of Koala has just been playing this so well.
A lot of early aggression, but we really haven't seen too many good setups afterwards. Now hitting level 6, that's going to allow a lot more pressure here. And you should see Leeson, yeah, going for the aggressive warrior in Shen. And the same thing for double aim. It's going to be about who's able to grab those first. It does look like double aim and Koala both similarly building. So shouldn't see too many discrepancies there until we see maybe boost, maybe a second item. Still looking for those big pickups.
But while Joshy being such a good support, or known to be such a good support, I'm quite excited to see what he pulls out in this Thresh Lake game. The epic saves. Will it be equivalent to Tom?
Yeah, it was actually kind of interesting to look at the Swiss lineup. I was like, okay, we've got players that are primarily strong in solo queue. These guys have been playing in a lot of Swiss LAN parties and big LAN events in Switzerland together. But when you look at the Serbian roster, these are guys that have competed on the EU Nordic East servers for quite a while. They've attempted to qualify for a Challenger Series a couple of different times under virtual gaming. And with a few minor changes to the roster, this is the lineup for virtual gaming. Of course, significant though those changes may be, the synergy is still there for Serbia. They do have a little bit more professional competitive experience to allow them to maybe have more strategic picks and bans. And all looking to go in here onto Lagali. There's a nice wall. Milica jumping through it. Nice Lantern to pull Karthus away, but the fight might still be on. Just kidding. Looking for a disengage.
Leeson coming in from the top as well. I would not risk it, especially with his...
Oh, nice dodge there. Safeguard away. Just kind of posturing against each other. Although Demented Clown actually has a pretty big zone around him with double aim there for follow-up. And in the meantime, of course, we've got Pride completely uninhibited by Bigfoot. He's going for, once again, that static shiv first. Ult used there, Demented Clown putting the pressure onto Wild Joshy. Some damage coming in from Pride, who does have that BF sword, but it's nothing in the face of that Braum. Now Cohen coming out, catching a lot of damage on the double aim. Flash forward, damage down, but is this a turnaround by Bigfoot? Lantern in there, the kick flash, Bigfoot! Back in the middle of the enemy team, saved there by Kindred, but here comes the Kindred counter, it's Karthus! Lock it down, one kill, will we see more? Bigfoot in a lot of trouble there, one more auto attack to take him down. Tumbling away, stealth is in there. One more auto attack, the reach on the Piltover, or not Piltover, Peacemaker, the Light Slinger getting in there for a double kill.
And I just need to mention, out of these two teams, the one that I think tilts the most, Serbia. So if they don't stay in this, if they don't keep this close, then they will have a lot of problems.
4-1, not quite deja vu because we saw such a strong start. I think it was 8-0 for a while there with Serbia in game one. Now kind of the opposite situation. Really, the mark of a very well-rounded team is not just whether or not you can, you know, get leads, snowball the leads, and then win the game, but whether or not you can play from behind as well as you can play from being ahead. Like, if you get ahead, like, sure, that makes winning the game easier. But the true test of a good team, whether or not you can win, things aren't quite stacked in your favor. So, not over by any means. We're only about 12 minutes into the game, and there's still advantages for both sides. Could go either way, but a big advantage that we've seen game one and now still in game two, that Colamax Hecarim that hasn't really clocked in. D-Drive Resonance getting clocked there on the Lagali, so a big chunk of damage down. And Milica, a lot of mobility there. Boots a bot before Karthus has, and so he's able to dodge away from a lot of those late wastes and make this lane a lot more difficult. You can see the Kindred mark there. A little bit of mind games on the Lagali, saying, is Kindred going to gank there? It looks like the answer is no. Positioning aggressively top lane, kill potential is on. There's the exhaust there, and immediately coming over the wall, Milica able to ult out of there. He's like, I don't want to fight that. Heads back in time.
Karthus is moving perfectly in lane. Every time he avoids that shadow, just making sure he does not get popped instantly. Very well done from Karthus. Oh, Lagali on this game. Such great, an amazing mid player.
Yeah, he's really versatile too, and keep in mind, traditionally plays those control mages, but has been facing a lot of troubles with bans. This could be a little bit rough for Joshy there. He's gonna drop that box. Does have Fry coming back in from the backside. Now, while Joshy probably pretty dead, but definite turnaround potential here from Yama. There's the slow, the kick back in, and Milica is down, a shutdown, and there's the culling again. Will it be enough to take down Demented Clown? Dodges away from the last part. There's the dash forward. Kindred ult for the save, but not necessarily necessary. Does still disengage successfully. Milica down, a blue buff steal imminent. See if double aim can secure that one to Serbia. Looking to get the smite, double aim, gets it, tumbles back over the wall, but blue buff's one thing, dragon is another, and of course, secured there by Switzerland, a big change even just between games one and two.
Now, Hecarim had the opportunity to teleport in behind there. I think he's just waiting to finish that Triforce so he can have that huge power spike and destroy the whole team at once.
No, but you're absolutely right, Marika. When it comes to teleports, you need to be able to push that button at the right moment. Definitely some right moments in there, but biding his time. That's something that's really interesting about teleport usage now, that you don't have it have the cooldown reduced when you TP to turrets. You see a lot more top laners saving that spell for a little bit longer instead of using it quite so liberally to get to lane. But we don't see Trinity Force completed just yet, but for Yamal, we've actually got that Sunfire Cave, which is a pretty big power spike for him. See whether or not that item discrepancy actually matters. We're going for a blue silly here. Koala scouting out Colamax. Goes back in. That is a little bit questionable. Jumping backwards. Fear is down. Needs to get that kick back to stay alive, but going back in, or at least looking for the engage here. Malphite has engaged opportunity. If he sees a four-man ult, that's what you want to go for. Lagali running backwards. Milica will take turret aggro. Okay, this Karthus is actually dead here, but will they be able to find any kills off of it? Malphite coming in, Yama just a little bit farther behind, only catching the support there with that unstoppable force. Teleport is coming in to turn this one around. Koala does get a kickback, no knockups off of that. Koala very low, back to the back, Ignite taking down, but it won't find the kill, and that's actually a really good turnaround by Serbia.
Yeah, Switzerland must not let this one go out of hand, because we also see what happens when Serbia's ahead.
Yama, man, he was trying so hard there, but of course in the end, sometimes that doesn't matter. This time around, though, got some potentials for engaged minions going.
Right, coming from the side, oh, he's seeing a
death sentence, lands on the Demented Clown, not the greatest grab target. That Unbreakable is definitely making him unbreakable as he dashes back away. A lot of damage down, and there's the burst from Pride! The Karthus respawns good, and it's gonna kill off Demented Clown and my vocal cords simultaneously. It's been a long day, so let's go ahead and maybe calm it down for a second. I'm gonna repair things over here while we wait for double aim and defended clown to respawn.
I must say that hook by Wild Joshi, you say it wasn't the best target, but it was a great bait. Great mate.
Certainly was, and double aim paying for it. So much burst from Pride here. That crit chance, actually ridiculous. He has gone ahead and completed this first major item. I guess the first item completed there for Bigfoot 2 in that rapid fire cannon. I was expecting the static shib. We've seen so many veins complete first this tournament, but definitely like the rapid fire cannon a little bit more. And of course, another Zeal most likely incoming after some Berserker Grease. No boots at all, actually, for Pride. That's actually kind of interesting. Enough mobility to get around without them, so nice to see. Maybe saving that gold, putting it into some items, and using those items to get kills. Pretty good score there, 403. And up 20 CS in the matchup as well. So Pride, a real source of strength here for Switzerland, and really a big turnaround from game number one. And you can just see how effective this has been for Switzerland. They're like, okay, well, what do we need to work on? Top lane matchup. Yama, much better situation here. Just stacking armor. Note that all he has to do is just not die, which was a big struggle in game one. Of course, while he's building tanky to be the front line, the rest of his team's building a lot of damage. But now Yama, oh, whoa. Wait, is that a... That was the shortest knockback ulti I have ever seen. Yama's still in a little bit of a rough spot, back underneath his turret.
And that's the perk of being mollified. You don't die. We see a fight going mid lane and...
Demented Clown, the recipient of all of that Lee Sin damage. Not sure you really want to all in the support like that. There's the culling, forcing him back away. Dashing back and forth, and damage is in there. Wild Joshi for the kill.
Handing that Braum a death sentence.
That box back there, great follow-up. And man, this duo so strong. Where was this in game number one? Just ridiculously strong for Switzerland.
They are going to trade inner towers as Switzerland will be pushing in mid.
They're trading inner towers indeed. Going for a kill there in the mid lane, continuing the push. Will they overstay here? Nope, backing out, continuing.
Vayne is a bit pushed, in my opinion. Backing out safely, though.
Yeah, it backs out, but you have to watch the cannon minion die. Heartbreaking. But better than dying yourself, Bigfoot, back to base. Zeal is purchased along with the components.
For static shiv.
For that static shiv. Exactly what I was going to say. So at least we're all on the same page. Malphite, though, a little bit rough to see him use that ult defensively, but with enough CDR there coming in from things like that Shroud, he's going to be able to have that ult up in just a few seconds.
With Dragon up in 50 seconds, Hecarim is pushing top because he just has that teleport up very soon. I'm sure they're going to contest this because you can't let another Dragon just go to waste, especially not against that Lee.
Good coordination here by Switzerland. They're saying, hey, let's go ahead and hit those recalls, get back to base, heal up, buy items, prepare for these big objectives. And it's actually exactly like you said, you can't let these strong power picks get out of hand for Serbia. So for Kolomax, his Hecarim's actually in a little bit of a rough space. He's kind of split between item builds, he's not rushing Trinity Force, and actually be really interesting.
But he feels free to push top now because Malphite is moving to Dragon. If Serbia can stall this Dragon, Hecarim can get that... Now he's backing out. This is the safe way out. He does not want to have that TP disadvantage against Malphite.
20 seconds and Hecarim gets home guards for free. This is a really kind of a great timing attack if you want to use some cross esports terminology. Hitting that right before Hecarim would be able to recall back to base and use that TP home guard. But able to kill off the dragon. That is the second dragon of the game for Switzerland.
Getting outplayed. Outrotated at least.
Should have seen that the dragon timer coming for Serbia. You know, gone down there and maybe gotten in position. But once again, just trying to stay safe. Draw out the laning phase maybe a little bit longer. We talked about how good Bigfoot is on the Vayne. See whether or not that's gonna pay off as the game draws on later and later. Vayne, hypercarious, the hypercarries in the right situations, but we'll need a little bit of time to continue to scale up.
Echo keeping up more farm than Karthus. I'm quite surprised with that.
Yeah, Karthus farms ridiculously well, but I guess Echo farms a little bit better. Of course, farming champions better as well, giving him that extra pressure in lane versus Karthus is all assassins really have. But a big item being picked up there in the static shiv for Bigfoot. Now, kind of on item parity, with the exception, of course, of that BF sword.
Malphite's flanking, but I'm sure there won't be much action going here. Not even tickling.
I'm going to go ahead and slam that down. Possible engages here. Koala not looking for the kick, just going to head. Oh, grab on to double aim. He will have to ultimate to save his life. Kick out of there would secure the kill. Going in, summoner heal there. Koala too far. The Lee Syndrome strong with this one, and a shutdown for double aim. So close.
His
so
mind close. Was telling him no, but his body was telling him yes.
Indeed, I think a few other people might have been shouting no. There's the flash, the slow onto Lagali. There's that lantern's a good skill. Yama, though, will be able to ult out to save himself or not. Actually, no, dies with his ultimate still available. While Joshi's shielding himself, will go down. Colomax with the kill. Mid lane, though, got Milica coming in with a kill there as well. Karthus ult coming down. It's going to be able to get at least one kill. A shutdown on the Vayne.
And this is the turnaround we've been waiting for from Serbia's side. They're playing well from behind. Quite to my surprise.
Like I was talking about earlier, you have to not only be able to play well with a lead, but with a deficit, able to come back. That is the true test of whether or not you are deserving of this third place spot at IESF. I don't think you're really going to start bearing up with that level of health, but just stacking up those continual charges off of those Skittle Crabs. Nice to see Double Aim able to get those stacks, still scaling up. And of course, the scaling's the real thing to talk about here for Serbia. You got Vayne, incredible scaling. Kindred, literally infinite scaling on those the jungle camps, giving that extra on-hit damage. Of course, Hecarim engage, always super strong. But one of the things that Serbia really needs to watch out here for from pushing like that.
Nissen not suiciding. Because that was the issue there. He went way to the... Oh, no, it was Yama that went quite deep as well. Or he got caught by Vayne. But definitely, if Lee Sin and Yama can just work around it, because they've been having the best synergy here at the competition, and they're just not showing it here in this game right now. But put a Karthus in the middle of the team fight. Let Maul fight alt. Let the Karthus die. He's going to do all the damage anyway.
Now, that's certainly the synergy that they're looking for, but I think the bigger question mark is going to come from this mid-push right here. We've got Bigfoot and Demented Clown pushing it up and back away. Okay, I was afraid they were going to overcommit there and get caught, but now positioning towards that top lane, maybe some pressure onto Baron. Double aim scouting that their path is clear all the way up top, and oh, Milica looking to come around from behind this turret. Clown is actually going to go for a harder flank there, but staying safe, defending that top lane turret. They focus towards the top lane, and it's interesting to see the way that both of these teams are handling their rotations. They've decided to stick Hecarim top this entire time, and now sending him down to the bottom lane to stop these newly pushing minions on.
If they want to win this next fight on the tower, they do need to get a hook on Vayne, because Vayne was free to attack that whole fight. I think after game, if we can see it, the damage dealt, she'll do quite a lot.
Yeah, 2-2 and 2 looking for the first big damage item. You know, Vayne hasn't completed boots either. So neither
he
one of
do
these.
A lot.
Yeah, neither one of these AD carries looking for boots as their damage item. So still continuing to look towards the top lane. Push coming in. Good defense earlier by Serbia, but not consistent enough to keep that alive. And now looking to pressure. Dragon's up in a minute, so we'll need to see a reposition for at least one of these teams, but the push is very, very committed to both sides to zone things out.
Both top laners have TP up, roaming around the bottom, playing around each other. Malphite back in the bot lane, just pushing it out, ready to come top, but seems everybody's getting ready for Dragon.
Indeed it does. Yeah, a few more seconds, but coming back from base, you got pink wards, regular wards, items being picked up, and you can see less than 1,000 gold on absolutely everyone on the Swiss team. Similar situation for Serbia, although they did just crest that on Vayne, but Bigfoot, a little bit of a weird spot for items, recalling probably 4 Berserker Grease. See what the item spot is. Yeah, it sells the potion instead, so really unwilling to upgrade those boots now that they are... Okay, no, he does sell the potion to get the boots. So first AD carry to complete boots. Not that that actually matters. What's going to be significant is whether or not Milica gets caught here. Dead Senate comes out, it's not. going to land. Dumping in there is actually Pride taking away the blue buff. That's pretty good, because when you get that CDR, he's also got the Essence Reaver. There we go. Wait a second. Essence Reaver coming out there as well. Very, very strong Lucian, and it's going to snowball that into a third dragon in a row. Extra move speed here for Switzerland as they look for the possibility to start this fight. Kolovac's running in. Laggily in a little bit of a rough situation. Decides to go in and hit the Nizon. Yes, that Glacial Fissure is going to be big. Lucian just gets assassinated immediately. There's Pride taking him down. Double amount of kills for me as well with that kill on to Karthus. But we'll see whether or not this killing is actually impactful. Not really doing a whole lot, but ushering Bigfoot away from the fight.
They will not be able to capitalize too much of this, but Switzerland, they're just running away with the dragons. If Serbia does not act fast, and I mean really fast, they're going to sit with a five-dragon team in the next 12 minutes.
In the preseason, I know a lot of teams don't really consider five dragons as a win condition, because
what?
if you're losing to five dragons, the game goes way longer than most games do. I've seen a lot of tendencies for games to end in 30-35 minute range, which really doesn't allow you to stall quite as much, but these games have actually been a little bit slower paced. We're 26 minutes in, and we do have those 20 kills, so not a kill a minute like we've seen some of these very aggressive games be.
Well, they don't want the Vayne to stack up either, because this is going to be scary. Lucian is just not going to be able to deal out the damage he does. And also, Malphite becomes slightly irrelevant late game if he misses his ult, because basically you have a Malphite ulting in, and then he's just sitting there doing absolutely no damage and just soaking up some. But nobody's going to focus him if he's just a tank.
I should probably clarify what I meant by five dragons not being on the win. I mean, sure, it's a great way to win the game, but if you're taking that long to win the game, at least in this current meta, it's not. You see a lot of teams able to win it before then, so not necessarily the first thing you think of. A lot of big items being completed for both sides. We've seen an Infinity Edge finally in there for Pride, while on the other side, Bigfoot probably looking for a Bloodthirster, if he does have those components in there as well. Red buff secured. Pride insanely strong at this point. But we do have some sources of strength on the other side. Double Aim's Kindred has been strong all tournament long. He's going to go ahead with a Yomu's Ghostblade. Armor penetration, a super good stat for Kindred because she deals percentage max health damage. Of course, when you have percentage reduction to percentage power, it's actually really effective. So you shred some of that armor off. Make those percents count for a little bit more.
Well, double A on Kindred has not been the same as last game. I mean, he was 0-3 just a little while ago. Picked up 3 kills, back in the game.
And all of a sudden, with very effective itemization there as well, if you leave that Kindred to deal damage over this next fight, he's been able to stack up a lot of stacks. We'll see how many actually has them. Trying to, trying to wait until they count that up. 10 stacks, holy moly! That is a lot of percentage max HP damage, so Double Aim's done a great job with those 3 kills off that comeback. Every single one of those have given him a stack on an enemy champion.
Will he just stack up more Malphite whenever? Now, the real question is, will Lee kick Vayne into the team for Malphite ult?
That's the combo. Koala going in, he's hunting Double Aim right there. Lee Sin does have flash up, so that kick flash combo available. Also some flashes for possible insects. You gotta keep an eye on this Lee Sin, exactly like you were saying, Marika. That's gonna be the combo you wanna watch out for. Oh, Kolovac doing his patented wait in the brush strategy. Will back out and lose that pink ward.
Karthus, he's reaching that point in the game. A lot of ages is fully stacked. I'm guessing we'll see a death cap next.
Should be looking for Void Staff here coming up in a little bit. And there's not a whole lot of magic resistance here, but you know that you're going to need that eventually. And I believe Void Staff earlier is actually pretty good, especially versus teams that do have a lot of magic resistance, not individually, but you do have things like Mercury Treads for a little bit, the big item, of course, being that Locket of the Iron Solari completed for Demented Clown.
Hoping to survive those cast results.
It's a great item to do. He actually has double shields in there from Locket and then the Face of the Mountain. So great itemization there. Demented Clown saying, look, I know what's going to kill us. It's going to be that Karthus ult afterwards. Wants to have an opportunity to save himself from it.
Switzerland just controlling the vision quite well in their jungle. There's no deep wards from Serbia, but this could turn ugly. Especially the fact that they can't get vision on Baron.
A little bit of a delay there towards the mid game. We're 31 minutes in, and so like we were talking about earlier, usually games may not go quite this long. Nice blue buff handed over to Lagali. That is a strong Karthus. The needlessly large rod coming out, like you said, possibly going for that death cap. Lagali on other champions does like to go that build, but I haven't seen what his Karthus builds look like. So like you said, just going for even more power. Blue buff gonna help him use that even more effectively. Coming back from base, Thresh restocking on that pink ward. Getting extra wards in there on the side stone. And
another dragon coming up. This is important. You cannot let them get that fourth dragon, because then one misstep and the maybe win condition running out of control.
Our helpful observer knows exactly what you're talking about, illustrating that there are in fact three dragons taken by Switzerland. Trying to zone things out there, and with the Scuttle Crab there as well, they'll be able to not only re-engage, reposition, back off.
They're going
in.
Baron.
Double aim. It's true, he actually does have those 10 stacks. So
they need to start it fast if they want to stop it. But late, they waited too long for this. They might be able to put it off, but Switzerland is incoming, and Malphite is ready to ult.
Oh, here we go. We've got to take a look at Yama. Bigfoot versus the Malphite. He's got that percentage health. Gets condemned into the wall. Yama's coming in, looking for it. Misses it completely. Yama is out of there. The Pride is strong enough to duel against Milica. Zanya's there, the culling to come out. There's the ult backwards, but needs to get this AD carry in the fight before Kolomax just carries it all out. Needs to see whether or not this Karthus damage is impactful. Going to give his shutdown to Pride. Pushing forward. There's double aim backing away. Lee Sin not done yet. Ward over the wall. There's the safeguard. Missing on the Sonic Wave. There's a double. Looking for the triple. Did he get it? It is a triple kill. Coming over to Pride.
They could have escaped that safely and they would have been able to deny the Baron by just poking. But that was just pure greed.
Also, do want to give a quick correction. Kindred with not 10 stacks. That's actually a 100 with the 0 cut off. So I was misreading that when I quickly checked the bar there. I think it's actually 2 stacks. What is Milica doing? Okay, ulting back away from there before he gets himself. Okay, he's not going to steal the Baron. It's already dead. There's no low health members to take out. Just the 1v4, which turns out is good to turn back time away from.
Surprise!
Lee Sin with that Hand of Baron. They're hovering over that to illustrate that he will be able to go in for these big pushes. And man, I don't know about this. This is going to get scarier and scarier for the Serbian squad. Now having to deal with Baron buff, you've also got to deal with an incredibly high scaling from Karthus, as he's looking to complete that Rabadon Zeth Cap, possibly his next item. Also could go for a Rylai's Crystal Scepter for some extra slow to maybe help keep the enemy team in his defile.
Well, you cannot cut Serbia's Hecarim out of this. I mean, Kolomax is just going to get stronger and stronger, and he's not been showing it this game as much, but it's coming. It's coming.
Certainly is, and we'll see what else is coming up the mid lane, as that does look like where Switzerland is, or was pushing, instead of turning their focus down towards the bottom lane. A couple of things to work on for Serbia would be at least limiting the effectiveness the Pride has had. It's been an absolute monster. While Joshi with the sickest play, still in range for that safeguard backwards. Yama does have his ultimate back available. Might want to turn this one around. Takes the Lantern instead of ulting defensively. Here comes in Kolomax, a little bit ahead of schedule. Is he not there to back him up? Does that Bigfoot, there's a good Malphite ult, knocks up three. A Bigfoot trying to guide away from that, but it's a double kill for Lee Sin. Koala's got a hat and a double kill. Milica, double aim. They're both on the wrong side of the wall. Well, I guess he's on the right side of that wall. Lagali moving forward, trying to cut them off. Needs to be careful. I think he is going to let double aim get away, just trying to delay the recalls, because we've got Switzerland in the base. They're going to take down a base turret. They're going to take down an inhibitor, most likely. Milica versus Lagali. That's the one that you want happening in the backside. Who's going to be able to get that to pick up that kill? Zanya's into death. It's Lagali coming out on top. Double lane though, still in with the damage. Karthazol won't kill Kindred through her ult now. Kicks her onto the fountain. She is out of there, and so might Serbia be with Switzerland. Putting down a lot of damage here onto the Nexus. It's going lower, and there it is. Going down, Switzerland taking game number two to bring us to a game three. This third and fourth place match.
At last, we get a best of three with three matches.
Exactly what we wanted all along. Congratulations, Switzerland, bringing it back. They'll take this win here in game number two and take us to a game number three. So you guys don't want to miss it. We'll be right back with more action from the 7th Esports World Championship here in Seoul, South Korea.